we meet people. We meet people going through different situations. We find out more and more and more people are struggling. You know, life is just complicated and people are going through different stuff. And it's just hard. Many people are stressed because of different things. Could be their job, could be a family situation. Nobody knows, but people are stressed. Many people are confused. They have a decision to make. And, you know, I don't know what to do. Right? Many people are depressed. This one is all over the place. Sometimes you don't even know people are depressed. But people are depressed. Situations of life are all around us. And the question is, what can you do? You know, I always sat and I wondered about it. But today, despite your problems, despite your circumstance, I want to introduce you and I want to encourage others to a man called Jesus, right? Who wants to turn your life around. And the topic this morning is Jesus meets you right where you are. Because a lot of times people are going through different stuff and they think they have to come to Jesus. You don't have to. Jesus will come to you, but you have to accept it. So one of the things that I realized when I was preparing this message is that when you're going to meet royalty or some big official, the president, whoever it is, someone, you know, who is well known and great, right? They don't come to you. You go to them. Now think about this. I can't just pick up the phone and say, "Hey, Donald, yeah, it's me." And Donald be like, "Who are you talking?" I'm like, "Come on, Donald, Trump, it's me, your friend Mario from Jamaica. I want to have a one-on-one with you. Just come and see me." I can't do that, right? He's going to be like, "I don't even know who Mario is." But think about this. Our God, our Savior, Jesus, came down to earth to be with us, right? So that he could meet mankind where he wanted to meet him. And this story here of the woman of the well depicts that. Because God, who is the Savior for mankind, came and met her at her local spot. Can you give me the other slide? Right? Look at this now. Now, he had to go through Samaria. So he came, right, to Sychar, a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given his son, Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. Now, if you're not too quick on thinking this thing through, if Jesus was really tired, stop right there. Yeah, he was tired, but I mean, if he was smart and really tired, he would go into the town where there is shade. But stopping there at the well, high noon? No. You don't rest at the well at high noon. Nobody comes to the well at high noon. Do you know why? The sun is hot. It's like 100-something degrees. Nobody draws water in the hot of the day. It's too hot. They come when it is cooler in the evening or early morning. So Jesus being tired, sitting down at the well, is saying to us, "I'm tired, but there's something to be done. So I got to stop here." And he sent his disciples to go buy food. Now, probably if it was me, I would have bought my food first, then come back to meet her, and then probably missed her. You know, because, you know, how I love my food. But Jesus stayed and sent his disciples to buy the food. Listen, even if you don't come to Jesus, Jesus comes to you. Wow, what a Savior. He came to this woman even though she didn't even know he was coming to her. He was waiting for her before she knew it. Listen, another thing that I realized about him sitting there at the well is that he got rid of all the distractions. And you're like, what are the distractions? One, the disciples. Go and buy food. When you come back, we'll talk. I'll be here. But Master, Tom is just like, you buy the food, I'll be right here. Didn't want the disciples there because the disciples would be a distraction. Listen, one thing I've learned is that when Jesus comes to you, sometimes when you're having your problems or your situations or whatever is happening, he tries to tell you, get away from the distractions. And you're like, why would Jesus say this? Because Jesus wants some one-on-one time with you. Wow. I wish I could just tell any important person, just like why I use Trump as an example. I wish I could call the Prime Minister of Jamaica because there's some things I don't like what he's doing. I wish I could say to him, sir, I need to have a one-on-one with you. Please see me in my office. He ain't coming. Right? But Jesus came to meet with her. He got rid of the distractions so that he could have some one-on-one time with her. Right? This is because Jesus wants to talk to each and every one of us personally. What a God that he wants to have a personal relationship with everybody. He doesn't want to see the family. He wants to see you as an individual. Wow. What a thing. We also notice that Jesus does not care what society says. He's concerned about your soul. Let's look at this. The Samaritan woman said to him, you are a Jew.
I am a Samaritan.
Look at that. I'm a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not what? Associate with Samaritans. I love the Bible. One of the things why I love the Bible so much is that it doesn't hide stuff. It's very clear. Racism. Yes, and the big R word. Racism. It's been around longer than what people made it out to be. And this black and white issue, it was way before that. Because look at this. Jews and Samaritans were the same skin color. No, that's the height of racism. When it's not about the skin color, they were prejudiced against them because they thought they were half-breeds. Wow. Yeah, that's it. I'm not lying. Look it up in history. They considered them less than. Wow, yeah, that's how serious it was. So, Samaritans and Jews, oil and water, they don't mix. That's where it was. So, the lady was saying to him, you are a Jew, I'm a Samaritan, and you are asking me for water? Don't you know we don't associate? Racism was key in that culture right here. Society said, don't talk to this person because this is what society said. Kind of like what we're facing now. We don't listen to them, but that's what society was saying. Listen, Jesus does not care about race. Jesus does not care about class. Jesus does not care about social standing, color. All Jesus is concerned about is your soul salvation. And I love that with him. He is just concerned about where man is going to spend eternity. That's it. He's not concerned where she came from, who she's been with, or whatever she's doing. All he was there for her was about her soul salvation. Now, this is the other part that I noticed about this when I was putting it together. Jesus already knows your situation. What? Yes, he already knows your situation. Look at this right here. It says, he told her, go call your what? Husband and come back.
Jesus was hitting something here, and you're like, what is so special about that? Why should she go call her husband? Listen to her response. I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, he's telling her facts now. You have had 5 husbands, and the man you are now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true. The woman had to agree with him.
Listen, Jesus knows the situation. He knows your situation before it happens. And this is a problem I have with most persons. We try to fix our situation before we come to God. You know, you say to somebody, I'm inviting you to church. And they're like, well, I'm going to come, but I have this situation. I need to go and fix this up. When I clean everything else up, then I'll come to church. I can't come to church the state I'm in. Church is the place you go to get cleaned up. That's what church is all about. So you bring the problems to Jesus. So don't try and fix the situation and then come to Jesus. Come to Jesus just as you are and let him fix your situation. Ta-da! Yeah! Bright stadium bulb going off in our heads there. Listen, this is another way some people say, well, Pastor, what you don't understand is my situation is crazy. You see, I'm not just a normal. My situation is crazy. Well, my response to you is Jesus specializes in crazy. Now, listen. Think about this. This woman, I know she's not well-liked in her community. Everybody could see that. That's why she came to the well at noon where nobody else was going to be there. Because probably the other ladies that saw her, she'd gotten a beat down. Think about this. 5 affairs with 5 married men. You think she would have learned, right? No, she's on her 6th. Wow. You know how much families were wrecked because of this lady? Think about it. And Jesus still wanted to save her soul. Can't get crazier than that. So don't think about crazy. I don't care how off your situation is. I don't care how crazy your situation is. Jesus still wants to save your soul. And finally, I realized this too, that Jesus wants to save your life with living water. Think about this. Jesus answered, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. That's the water here that's in the well. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will be becoming in them a spring of water welling up into eternal life. Wow! Look at that. Jesus was saying to them, I know you're thinking about the physical water. Don't worry too much about the physical water. Let me talk to you about your spiritual life, what is happening. You see, when we accept Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, he changes the desires of our heart. You know, some people say to me, Mario, you're a very nice guy. But if I didn't have Jesus in me, I wouldn't be so nice. I can tell you that. Many of you would say, that Mario's not so good a nice guy, not so nice of a person. Jesus is the one that changed me. He's the one that made me such a nice guy. Mario alone? Not so good. Mario and Jesus? Yeah. That's better. Trust me. He changes your heart. He gives you different desires. And you know, one thing I've realized when Jesus gives you this water springing up into you into everlasting life, think about it. This water that he gives you not only transcends from this life, but it transcends from the life to come. Wow. Yesterday when I heard that my friend had died, it shook me. I was sitting at the table, my sister was there, and you know, she was talking to me about it. But it shook me. But then I got back my composure because it was a man that loved God. He was a man of God. He wasn't someone that didn't love God. He was someone that served all the days I knew him. He was serving God. Right? And that gave me hope to say, I'll see him again. So basically, that's what Jesus is saying here. Jesus is saying, I change your life here on earth, but I also give you a new eternity after you've passed on. Think about that. That's something that Christians long for and hope for. It's so powerful that a friend of mine, her dad was dying. And he was on the deathbed, heart failing, lungs failing, kidney, everything was failing, just to make it short. And she was there at the bed, you know, holding his hand and stuff, looking at him. Finally, he opened his eyes and he went like this. And she says, Dad! And he says, huh? And she says, it's me, your daughter. And he's like, what are you doing here? And she said, what are you talking about, Dad? It's me, your daughter. You're in the hospital. He's like, I'm still alive? He said, I thought I was dead. I was opening my eyes to see Jesus and be in heaven. And she said, Dad, why are you trying to go away and leave me? He says, listen, you don't understand. This life here is the short one. I'm excited to go live my eternity. And she was just like, she just couldn't understand. She's grieving, but he's ready to go. He died a little bit after. But the fact of the matter is, the testimony he left in those last minutes was like powerful than what probably he had lived for his entire life. Because this man was ready to pass on to see his maker. In conclusion, what I want us to hear this morning and what I want us to understand this morning is Jesus does not care about your distractions. He cares about your soul. Jesus does not care what society says. He cares about your soul. Jesus does not care about your excuses. He cares about your soul. Jesus cares about us. The most precious thing in this world to him is us, humanity. And that's why over 2,000 years ago on the cross of Calvary, he died for our sins. And what I want to leave with us this morning, for those persons who might be here, and you might not know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, let me tell you this. If Jesus is coming to meet you where you are, accept him. Don't turn your backs on him. Because you never know when, the day, or the hour, when your time is going to be wrong. If somebody had told me that I would never get to talk to Gerald again, I would have said, you're crazy. Last week, my phone got reset and I lost his number. I remember asking some persons for numbers. And when I was finished, I said, oh, I didn't ask them for Gerald's number. I'll ask them another time. What use is the number now? Because I'll never get to talk to him again. I'm saying, Jesus Christ is knocking at the heart's door of individuals. And I always have to share a message like this because we take for granted everybody that comes to church are Christians. If that was true, then there would be no need for church. We always have to remember the person out there who has the circumstances of life all around them. The circumstances that they don't tell us. The person who is depressed at home. The person who is going through whatever. We don't know. But all I'm saying to you this morning is, if you're depressed, if you're going through stuff, whatever it is, Jesus is here to meet you. Accept him. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Eternal God and most righteous Father, we just thank you for your word, dear God. Sometimes we're here and sometimes we forget that we're not the only ones in this life, facing different struggles. Sometimes because we're Christians and we have a hope in you, we forget about our brother and our sister who is sitting beside us, who does not know you, dear God. So today, this morning, we are praying on behalf of them. We are praying for them. They might not know you as personal Lord and Savior, but we pray for them today, dear God, that they might just say yes to you. Dear God, they might be sitting here and say, I don't know what to say to Jesus. How do I get this Jesus? Dear God, we pray it's so simple. You don't need any big words. You don't need a dictionary. You don't need a degree, a certificate. Dear God, you say just come to you humbly and say, God, please forgive me. Forgive me of all the sins I have done. And dear God, I'm asking you now to help me come into my heart and take over this life. I can't do it by myself, dear God. I've been trying for how many years, and I just can't do it. So I'm asking you to take full control of my life. Dear God, if anybody that is under the sound of my voice that has done that this morning, let them be assured and let them know, dear God, that they have just confessed to you and asked you to take their lives. And dear God, just help them to start their spiritual journey today. So God, we thank you for allowing us to be here. We're thankful for your word. Dismiss us now in love. And we give this service over to you. And we continue praying for those who need to find you in your heart. In Jesus' name we pray.